Hi, I'm Annie from Ticketmaster, and we're here with Ned Boulting, and he's going to have a chat to us about his upcoming tour.
That's the idea.
Yeah.
That's what I'm hoping is going to happen. Otherwise, yeah. It's going to be a long, awkward pause, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'm sure you've got loads of questions lined up.
Heaps of questions. So, can you just give us a little bit of an overview of what the whole show is about, really?
Well, it's kind of one of those where the name of the tour goes some way to explaining it. So, unless you've got kind of at least a passing interest or affection for two-wheeled contraptions that were invented 200 years ago, you're probably not best served coming along. But that leaves a billion people who are interested to come along, because cycling is one of those things that once it gets a grip on you, it kind of has a place in your heart, and you just become quite weirdly obsessive quite quickly. So I'm probably familiar to people who watch the Tour de France, especially because for 15 years I've been part of the Tour de France kind of presentation team on the telly. But also, last year I decided to kind of make a theatre show out of the love affair that people enjoy with the bike. So it kind of touches on, it's supposed to be funny, right? It's supposed to be a laugh, first and foremost. And it touches on that weird thing that people do when they get into cycling, where they connect the kind of real top end of the sport, you know, the yellow jersey of the Tour de France, with their own lived experience of jumping on a bike and just riding down to the shop.
Great.
You know? So so it's a bit of everything, yeah, it's a bit of all of that.
Mm. And if you know a little bit about bikes, but not the ins and outs of it, do you think that you'll still be very interested in this kind of show?
I offer a welcoming hand to those few people on the planet who aren't interested in bikes. No, I mean, anyone can come along, and weirdly, my mum couldn't care less about bikes, and she found it quite fun. But then she's my mum.
Yeah.
I hadn't really thought that one through, is it? She's bound to be biased.
Some kind of bias will be
there.
Yeah.
No, of course. Yeah.
Good. And so you're in Edinburgh at the moment. You've done a couple of shows. The final show today.
Yeah.
Are you happy or sad about that?
Well, right now I'm nervous about it because it starts in about an hour. And it's weird. I've been working in telly for 20 years. Live telly, you know, I used to cover football, and I've covered World Cups and Champions League finals and this, that and the other for ITV in particular then. And weirdly, telly never makes me nervous, even though sometimes you're broadcasting to 20 million people, you know, literally.
Yeah.
But the thing of stepping on stage is it's just so rewarding, and it's that live kind of feedback and everything. But boy, with about an hour to go, the beads of sweat start to sort of appear. But it's a laugh, it's fun.
So I'm very happy that you get to have a chat to us
in this
time.
Yeah.
And I guess you've just come off the last tour.
Is
it just exhausting as a comment, just following it around? It's got to be, right?
Well, it's a one-man show. So I mean, because it's not my day job, I dip in and out of it. Last year I did 14 dates. This year, starting on October the 10th in Sheffield, I'm doing 25 dates that finish in the West End in London at the big one, actually, Lyric Theatre in Shaftesbury Avenue.
Yeah,
that's the final date on November the 27th. So that feels like, to me, a lot, right? But then I realise when I'm touring up and down the country that I'm sharing, you know, 2 days before me, some stand-up comedians have been, and I catch up with them sort of like a week later, and they've been there 2 days after me. And I look at their tour dates, and they're doing like 180 shows in a year. I take my hat off to them. I doff my cap in respect, because that's insane.
Yeah.
It's a tough way to earn a living, but it's brilliant.
Yeah.
And it's just great fun. It's great fun.
Do you find it harder doing a live tour in comparison to following the Tour de France?
Ah, that's good. So the one thing they have in common is loads and loads of time spent on the motorway, because the Tour de France is such a beautiful event. It's such an insanely wonderful, rich seam of stuff that you can talk about, the stories it throws up. But the real pain in the ass about the Tour de France is it doesn't stay still.
Yeah.
You know, the clue's in the name. Sort of unlike any other sporting event, like, you know, sometimes I just long to cover Wimbledon.
Yeah.
Where you can sit in a press box in the same place for 2 weeks in a row, and never really bother your ass with the rest of it. The Tour de France has a habit of moving 400 kilometres on every single day.
Yeah.
So you just spend forever on the motorway, dipping in and out of French motorway service stations and getting a stale tuna baguette. By the way, French cooking, don't believe a word of it. Don't believe. It's not the country of great cuisine at all.
You really have to know where you're going when you get there.
Yeah.
And I guess because as a viewer, you get to see all the beautiful landscape and you're watching the bikes and things, but you're just driving from spot to spot and then sitting in a commentary box all day, really.
Correct. And that's the other weird thing is we commentate on the Tour de France. I commentate with David Miller, and we sit in a dark, windowless box in the back of a truck parked up at the finish line in some anonymous French provincial town.
Yeah.
And much like you at home, who may be just watching it on the telly, that's all we're doing. We're just watching it on the telly. We never actually see the race because it's happening 150 kilometres away up a mountain.
Yeah.
You know, and eventually it'll come to the finish line where we are, but we don't even see that bit of it. So you don't actually see the race. You just watch. What a weird job.
Yeah, it sounds glamorous. I must admit.
It's not. I love it with a passion, but it's a bit... I've just explained it to myself and for the first time realised how crap it is. It's a crap job. Can I have your job?
Yeah, sure. Better. If you want, we'll swap. Can we swap? Yeah. I'd love to swap, actually. Totally. Okay, so final question, I guess, about the Tour de France.
Yes.
This year's was...
Are we going to talk about doping?
No, I won't. I won't do that to you.
Are we not going to talk about doping?
No, I won't do that to you. It was a bit of a crazy one this year.
That's the first ever interview I've ever done.
Yeah, that's why I'm not going to do that.
About cycling, we haven't talked about doping at all. So, like a fool, I mentioned it.
Yeah, why would you bring it
up? Why
did I do that? It was a crazy one this year.
What?
What was the biggest disappointment for you? What was the biggest highlight for you? I'm guessing it's going to be a Froome win, but...
Well, yeah. I mean, he's an interesting case, that guy, you know, because a lot of people find it really struggle to identify with him.
Yeah.
I don't know whether it's the passport thing that, you know, British sporting public don't really buy his British nationality,
they
you know, because he's not British, kind of. He's kind of Kenyan.
Yeah.
So, but you have to acknowledge, I think you have to acknowledge at the very least, and we touch on this in the show, you have to acknowledge the scale of his achievement. He's not just the best bike racer in the world at the moment. He's one of the best there has ever been in 104 of editions of the Tour de France.
Yeah.
I mean, literally, he is one of the greatest stage racers there's ever been.
Yeah.
And yet, we still kind of struggle with identifying ourselves with him. Yeah. So, you know, it was a close race this year.
Yeah.
Closest, he's never been pushed that hard.
Yeah.
That happened. You have to take your hat off for that. But there were loads of, you know, often the beauty in the Tour de France is with the other little bits and pieces. And we saw emerging French talent.
Yep.
On this race, and for me, I have a soft spot for France, despite their crap sandwiches.
Yeah.
And one of these days, you know, the next race I want to call is one where either Warren Barguil or Romain Bardet, you know, or one of these new guys comes to the fore and finally wins it for the home nation. Because boy, do they need it! You know, it's like Wimbledon and Andy Murray all over again, but on steroids. You know, I mentioned doping.
No.
I've mentioned doping
again.
They're not on steroids.
Any
of them.
Okay, cool. And low light.
Well, it was a shame that Mark Cavendish crashed out again, because it's agonising. He's an astonishing guy. He changed everything for me on the Tour de France, you know, in 2008 when he started winning. He changed my entire perception of what British athletes were capable of on the race. He's won 30 stages. Only the great Eddie Merckx has won more than him, 34 stages of the Tour.
Yep.
And I know that Cavendish is obsessed with tracking down and hunting down that record. But year on year, it gets incrementally harder for him to close that gap. Just four more wins. It would have been a big opportunity this year. And, you know, he crashed out in spectacular fashion early on. And that was a disappointment. And the wonderful Peter Sagan, the world champion, was sent home as well. A rubbish decision.
Sad.
Rubbish decision by some rubbish UCI comment. Just because he's great, isn't he?
Yeah,
with his hair.
Yeah, he's just a superstar.
And his hair. And his hair, he's got a lot of hair and a lot of talent. And he's a wonderful guy, Peter Sagan. Peter Sagan.
Yeah.
And also, the interviews you give, also
very good.
Very good interview with hair, Peter Sagan.
Yeah.
Yeah, we missed him, didn't
Brilliant.
We?
Brilliant. All right. Yeah. So, I guess we should kind of wrap it up there. But
I think so.
Yeah.
not because of you're doing great, but I'm about to mention, I can tell I'm going to mention doping again in a second. And I really don't want to.
So if anyone wants to hear you talk about doping, is it on the tour then?
Yeah, no, we don't mention it.
Yeah.
We don't mention it. We don't mention Lance Armstrong once.
Brilliant. All right. So where do they need to go to see you?
To the theatre.
Yep, cool.
Starting in Sheffield on October 10th. All on the website, Bikeology, you know, whatever.
And Ticketmaster.
And Ticketmaster, which is why you're doing this.
Yeah.
And you sell tickets on Ticketmaster, don't you?
Yeah, we do.
So go and buy them. Simple.
Yeah.